The inborn talent myth persists because those who seek to understand why people are different from one another don't think to look for developmental explanations. Babies arrive in the world with extremely malleable brains and the inborn drive to mold themselves into whatever the caretakers indicate they want them to be. The molding takes place bit by bit every day of a child's life. The result is a transformation in which a generic human being, having nearly all of the same DNA as anyone else, becomes a unique individual who reflects its family's culture in the ways it thinks, acts, feels, and looks. We are unique, but not genetically unique. We are unique because we have been shaped in singular fashion by family cultures throughout our early years. Family cultures either set us free or clamp us down for much of our lives. Some family cultures propel offspring to reach for the sky, while others teach them to never look up.
I should have hit him when I had the chance. He'd be dead now. No more worries.
I'll talk to him, dear. I'll tell him he either has to get a job or go to college.
College? So he can thumb his diploma at me?
Abe never thumbed anything at anybody.
That's because he never went to college. Besides, he's probably too stupid to get in.
Shh! He'll hear you.
I don't care! It's my house! Besides, he doesn't speak English anyway.
I'm sure he'll find a job somewhere.
He couldn't find a job to save his life. It's worthless, Evelyn. I tell you, I die of shame every time I see him. Goddamn lazy freeloader.
So your parents asking what you're gonna do?
I think they're getting curious.
Sure miss playing basketball. I got depressed as hell when my athlete's foot and jock itch went away.
So why'd you give it up?
Oh, I don't know. I was sure I was gonna get that scholarship. My dad, of course, was sure that I wouldn't. When I didn't, he was really understanding, you know? He loves to do that. He loves to be understanding when I fail. That's okay, Cyril, I understand. He even bought me that guitar because he's sure I'd never learn to play it.
Well, I'm supposed to take this college entrance exam.
Are you gonna go to college?
Hell no. I just want to see if I could pass.
Huh. Maybe I'll take it too and flunk it. My dad's birthday's coming up.
Chasing a stupid dream causes nothing but you and everyone around you heartache. Notre Dame is for rich kids, smart kids, great athletes. It's not for us. You're a Rudiger. There's nothing in the world wrong with being a Rudiger. You can have a damn nice life. Frank is going to take over plant number two. In a couple years. He'll make more than me and Johnny. You know he's in charge of the expansion program.
I don't want to be Frank or John.
Many of you watching this video know a good deal about never look up family cultures. Here are three examples of family cultures that taught children to reach for the sky.
I was an ordinary person who studied high. There's no miracle, people.
Richard Feynman became a child prodigy because his father, a businessman, was passionate about science and did all he could to interest Richard in science and mathematics throughout his childhood. With his father's encouragement, Richard learned about science by studying from the Encyclopedia Britannica as a young child. He also learned elementary mathematics before reaching grade school, and trigonometry, differential and integral calculus, and complex numbers long before he took those subjects in high school and college. Feynman knew how hard he worked to achieve what he did, and he was honest enough to admit it. True believers in the inborn talent myth will claim that Feynman learned much math and science as a young child because of his inborn ability. when in reality he learned it because of his strong desire to please his father. It is easy to imagine that his father responded with enthusiasm whenever little Richard came to him to brag of his latest accomplishment, in contrast to a less interested father who would have brushed him off with, "Let Daddy watch the ball game." Basking in the glow of his father's praise and spurred on by the fear of disappointing him, Richard quickly developed superior study habits that made schoolwork seem easy to him. Having been trained to a higher level than his schoolmates, he appeared to them as to be a genius. A similar story can be told of any child reared in a family culture that encourages and rewards accomplishment. Why do some children do better at school than other children? Because their family culture prepared them better for schoolwork than the family cultures of their schoolmates. Inborn talent is never involved. Shinichi Suzuki was a Japanese musician and educator who developed a method of music education that is renowned for teaching small children how to play musical instruments. Type in Suzuki method in the YouTube search engine to see videos of 2, 3, 4, and 5-year-olds playing violins and pianos with amazing dexterity. The secret to the method's success is creating a family culture centered on music. Suzuki children receive musical training of one type or another nearly from birth. They awaken to music, hear it throughout the day, and are put to bed with it playing. Their parents are deeply involved as home music teachers from the beginning. At least one parent often learns to play the instrument being taught to the child, stimulating the child's desire to imitate the parent as the two practice together. Suzuki students regularly listen to expert recordings of the tunes they are mastering and are encouraged to imitate what they hear. The students are also encouraged to accompany other students in musical ensembles and to perform in front of audiences in solo recitals. Through it all, parents remain the child's constant support system, sustaining the child's desire to continue creating music. And, of course, Suzuki Method students also have music lessons once or twice a week, conducted by professional teachers. The Suzuki approach is in contrast to more typical musical instruction, in which parents are satisfied to purchase an instrument and set up music lessons, leaving it to the child to struggle practicing on the instrument alone, while siblings and maybe even parents complain about all the noise the child is making. More than 250 years after his birth, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart remains the ultimate example of a prodigy whose abilities seemingly can be explained only by supposing the presence of inborn talent. Wolfgang began learning to play the harpsichord when he was 3 years old. By the time he was 4 years old, he could play pieces lasting half an hour. By 6, he could play the violin well enough to participate with adults in trios and quartets, and he was gifted with perfect pitch, too. As if all that were not enough, little Wolfgang was a budding composer. Wolfgang wrote a minuet when he was 5 years old. He began composing music in earnest when he was 6, and he wrote his first symphony when he was 8. He wrote an oratorio and several piano concertos at 11, and an opera at 12. What are we to make of all this? As always, it is good to start with basic truths. 99.95% of Wolfgang's DNA was the same as anyone else's. Wolfgang's accomplishments must have other explanations. Wolfgang's mother, in effect, washed her hands of Wolfgang and his older sister, telling them to always obey the dictatorial father, Leopold. Leopold dominated every aspect of life in the Mozart household, including his children's homeschooled education. Wolfgang remained desperate for his father's approval throughout his life. Leopold was a singer and violinist who worked as a musician in the Salzburg court in Austria. He also was a run-of-the-mill composer of mainly church music that is almost never played today. Leopold explained his lack of success as prejudice on the part of higher authorities. He felt that he had been deeply wronged, which led him to search for a means of restoring his status. Wolfgang was to be his main instrument of self-restitution. The Mozart household duplicated the conditions called for by the Suzuki method, but Leopold took everything to extremes. Wolfgang probably heard music most days of his infancy. He heard his father practicing for performances, trying out musical phrases while composing, and the music of Leopold's students as they struggled to satisfy him. When Wolfgang was 3, he began hearing something new from his older sister as she started taking harpsichord lessons from their father. Almost immediately, Wolfgang began to imitate his sister in a bid to muscle some attention away from her. It is perhaps at this time that the idea began to grow in Leopold's head of using his children to gain the fame and fortune that had been stolen from him. Leopold began an intense program of musical training for both children, with a focus on little Wolfgang, whom he taught the violin, harpsichord, and clavichord, in addition to musical composition. Wolfgang practiced relentlessly, not unusually all day long. Leopold increased the pressure on Wolfgang more and more, as he became committed to the idea of giving concerts in selected European cities with his children. When Wolfgang was 5.5 years old, Leopold took the children to Munich, Germany for 3 weeks of concerts. During the following fall, the family went on a 3-month trip to Vienna, Austria. These successful concerts led to a grand tour of 88 European cities and towns, including Prague, Paris, Zurich, and London. During the 3.5-year concert tour, all three played often to audiences ranging from royalty to the middle class. Little Wolfgang, dressed as a court minister complete with a white wig, was the main attraction. It is easy to imagine that Leopold's pressure on both children became maniacal in the days leading to concerts, and before each performance when perfection was essential. Given the years of intense training Wolfgang received, is it surprising that his performance skills were incredibly sophisticated at an early age? Is there really a need to posit the existence of inborn talents to explain them? I think not. But what of Wolfgang's perfect pitch? Although long thought to be an innate talent, perfect pitch is now known to be a natural result of a child receiving much musical training when very young. Training explains Wolfgang's accomplishments as a young composer, too, as far as we know. There are problems in assessing this record, as the only testimony that we have comes from Leopold, who by now was Wolfgang's publicist in addition to being his manager and booking agent. The only surviving copy of Wolfgang's Symphony No. 1 is in Leopold's hand. Wolfgang's Symphony No. 2 is now known definitely to have been written by Leopold. Wolfgang's Symphony No. 3 is now attributed to Carl Friedrich Abel, a London-based composer. Apparently, Wolfgang wrote out the symphony in his own hand in order to have a copy of it, and later on people assumed that it was his own composition. So Wolfgang's Symphony No. 4 is actually his second symphony, or maybe his first. And even here there are questions about the extent of Leopold's contributions. The same applies to the piano concertos that Wolfgang composed at 11. Although these were considered original compositions for many years, musicologists eventually realized that they all were based on relatively unknown sonatas written by others. Apparently, Leopold had assigned these to Wolfgang as compositional exercises to get him comfortable with the structure of piano concertos. Little in them is original to Wolfgang, and they provide evidence that Wolfgang was continuing to receive a great deal of help from his father. The first serious compositions that can be attributed to Wolfgang were written when he was 15 or 16, after more than a decade of serious study under his father's tutelage. So there is no solid evidence that he did compose any significant music on his own before he was a teenager, and good reason to believe he did not. And when he did unequivocally begin to compose music that was original and sophisticated, he had been training in composition for a decade or so, which is a normal amount of time for any student. The movie Amadeus contains the claim that Wolfgang could compose whole pieces of music in his head.
Astounding. It was beyond belief. These were first and only drafts of music. But they showed no corrections of any kind. Not one. He had simply written down music already finished in his head. Page after page of it, as if he were just taking dictation.
How could Wolfgang do this? He couldn't, and didn't. The scene is based on a lie. According to Alan Gannett, in his book The Creative Curve, the scene was based on a forged Wolfgang letter that was quoted in 1815 by Johann Rochlitz, the publisher of a German music magazine. Again, according to Gannett, Wolfgang worked long hours on his compositions. In an authenticated letter, Wolfgang described a set of string quartets he composed as the fruit of long and laborious effort. Like other composers, Wolfgang would begin by writing rough drafts as he explored various parts of his compositions. The idea that Wolfgang composed pieces entirely in his head was not true. In his authenticated letters, he makes it very clear that he wrote at a keyboard, as he needed to hear the notes of his compositions as he was working. In summary, there is no evidence for, and plenty of evidence against, the claim that Wolfgang Mozart was a prodigy whose accomplishments cannot be understood as the result of unrelenting hard work. Since we're talking about pathogenic beliefs, we should perhaps ask whether Wolfgang's father induced Wolfgang to develop any pathogenic beliefs about himself through his extreme insistence that Wolfgang perform musically at a high level. Since no biographies of Wolfgang were written before more than 30 years after his death, it is impossible to say. But what we do know is certainly suspicious. It could very well have been that Leopold communicated to Wolfgang that he had no worth as a human being unless he was producing music. If Wolfgang had internalized this attitude, it would help explain his tremendous musical output. Wolfgang composed more than 600 pieces of music in his short 35 years of life. It would be sad to contemplate that behind all that beauty was the feeling that he was a worthless human being when he wasn't making music.